The Bible. It's an important book, right? Still the bestseller around the world. Have you read it? What did you think? Was it hard to read, hard to understand? A few nice stories, but you really can't see the relevance of it in the 21st century. I want to help you. Just give me 2 sessions to try and explain the Bible and help you discover that it has power.
It's meant to be opened, explored, pursued. It's made to be read, reread, applied, and used. The sword of the Spirit, the Word of God, with wisdom, life-changing, to lead us on. It's made for guidance, to teach us His ways, showing what's true, right, and worthy of praise. It's meant to be hidden, deep in our hearts, daily examined as the morning starts. No greater glimpse of God do we have, a lamp to our feet and a light to our path.
It is Sunday morning, and we are glad that you are here. We're glad that you joined us on YouTube as well. And we gather today to worship God, to hear His word, and to receive His love. And our purpose as a church is to bring people together and to the Lord Jesus Christ. We are a family, and we are here to support each other, to encourage each other in faith and practical ways. And as we worship today, let's remember that God is always with us, no matter what we're going through. He loves us unconditionally, and He wants the very best for us. Maybe last week you had your own tensions, you had your own pressures. Maybe relationship with God even was tried and tested or poured in different directions. Let's today refocus on the Lord and renew our relationship with Him. So we begin our worship today with kind of 1.5 songs. The first one is Here I Am to Worship, and then straight after that we will just sing O Come Let Us Adore Him.
Together, love me, all together, worthy, all together.
here we are to worship. We're here to bow down. We don't come casually to worship you. We don't come just with our hands in our pockets and just turning up and singing a song. But we come because we love you, because you are our God, and we want to honor you and worship you with our words and with our deeds and with our thoughts. So, Lord, we lift up our praise to you now. For you alone are worthy of our praise. You are our mighty, pure God, the Alpha, the Omega, the constant in all of life and time and space. And thank you, Lord, that right here in Highfield on this Sunday morning, you, Almighty God, you are here amongst us. Thank you, Lord, for that understanding of you. And Lord, as we read your word later, help us to understand it better. Lead us through this time that we spend together, that it might be something worthy of being in your presence. Lord, we pray these things in the name of Jesus. Amen. Just reminded me, as it's mentioned, the Trinity. After we've done these 2 weeks of understanding the Bible, we are going to have another series of three this time about the Trinity. Seemed logical to have 3 weeks on the Trinity. So understanding the Trinity, what is that about? If you're trying to get to grips with the Bible these 2 weeks, trying to get to grips with God in three persons, that is coming up as well. So, Steve, come and pray.
Morning. Are we saved?
Yes.
Be confident.
Yes.
Do you believe you're righteous?
Yes.
You've been made righteous.
Yes.
Amen? So therefore, you must believe you have the authority. It gets quieter when you get to the end, doesn't it? But it's true. It's true. You are gifted with the authority from on high. I always remind people about this when it comes to prayer, because it's not just words in the air. We are not casting spells. Because Ephesians, quote me if I'm wrong, says we are, present tense, seated by the right hand of God. You know the scripture. Present tense, right now. That means you're in the spirit, and you can't sit there unless you have the authority and the blessing to do so. So whatever you say down here goes. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. So assert yourselves in the spirit and speak with power. Father, we thank you that you have brought us, despite our iniquity, despite our misgivings and our frailty and our limitedness and our finiteness, Lord, you have chosen to fill us with eternity. Thank you, Lord God, for the fellowship of your Holy Spirit. We pray, Lord God, you will help us be people who stand on your word and realize that the righteousness and the authority you have given us as we speak. We thank you, Father, for this great, great blessing and great responsibility. And so, Lord, with that, we pray, Lord God, for our local area. We pray for an impact and an outpouring of your Holy Spirit upon everyone who lives in this area. We are living in dark times, and there is a huge amount of confusion and worry and all sorts of false ideologies, and some, most of which have come straight from the pit. Lord, we pray that the presence of your word and your spirit will renew to it, and that, Lord God, you will help us be a stronger light for you. Wherever we are, let people see you in us, in this community that we live in. We pray, Lord God, for a blessing upon the work of our hands in this place. Give us wisdom about what we should put down, what we should pick up, and where we must change. Lord, I pray that you will keep us steadfast in love and help us build our trust in you. And I pray, Lord God, that you will take us, help us learn to take your hand, because there are dark times, and there are confusing times, and sometimes we are afraid of what may lay ahead. But Lord, wherever we are going, you are already there, and by your mercy you walk the path with us. So as a church, Lord God, we give you everything we are doing. We give you this building. Thank you for the fantastic ways that you have provided and continue to provide. Lord, on the wider scope politically in the area, Lord, there has been some big sea changes in the political landscape. And Lord, there are good people as well as bad eggs on every aspect of the political spectrum. But wherever they are, Lord God, we pray that you would raise up men and women who are right with you, who have at least an affinity to your principles, your morals, the morals of the scriptures, Lord God. A clear sense of what is right and wrong before you as well as man. We pray, Lord God, for the wider nations in Europe, the mess that is now emerging in the Far East. We pray, Lord God, that you will be merciful. We thank you for the stories that are leaking out that do not get onto mainstream media. But there are people coming to you. There are Palestinian men who are disillusioned and afraid and have been coming to you and giving their lives to you by the hundreds, but it's not reported because you are at work. We understand how the media works, but we thank you for your blessings, that even in those places there have been miracles, there have been accounts of divine intervention. And Lord, you are even in those dark places. We thank you, Father, for sparing the lives of so many. But at the same time, Lord God, we pray that you will bless the work of the hands of the relief agencies and that you will give all the leaders wisdom, especially the leaders of the Arab nations, that you will help them, Lord God, see, sense where it is needed, and that they will see the bigger picture, and they will understand that what violence and all this stuff is actually standing for, that it's anything, Lord God, that endangers and ridicules and wipes out human life. Lord God, it's not good. We just pray for your merciful hand in all those situations. And help the churches, Lord God, that are there. There are many churches, many little house groups dotted around in countries where they are heavily persecuted. And pray that you will be with them and strengthen them and help them. And for those that have been caught, we pray that you will have mercy upon them. There are Christians, believers in you, who are in chains, being tortured and neglected terribly, simply for believing in you. We pray, Lord God, that you will be with them and help them and sustain them. That we have our part to play because we are also part of that picture. Help us right here, right now, be who we need to be. In Jesus' name, amen.
It's always good to hear what God is doing in people's lives. And we do that regularly here at Highfield. And it's good to know that God is working in people's lives now. Not last month, last year, last decade, but now. So please do come and share something of what God is doing in your life. Just be brief. And so we have a few people doing that. So there's a queue already. Let's come and do that.
Change of mind. Morning. I wasn't going to come up the front until about 15 minutes ago, and it was like a miracle happened. So long story short, I've cut people's hair for years. I've never charged for their haircuts, and I've done it happily and freely, and I've cut my own hair and everything. And I was going through a really low time, and I thought, and Steve said, why don't you treat yourself and go and have your haircut at the hairdressers? I couldn't face the hairdressers because it's all mirrors. So in the end, I found a mobile hairdresser, and I went to a house. There was no mirrors, which was a bit worrying. And so I didn't see what she did, and it wasn't cheap. And I was like, whoa, okay, I got my money's worth, but it was load shorter than I asked for. So the whole experience did not cheer me up at all, made me feel worse. But you get over it, because it grows, and that's fine. And that's the end of that story. And then I saw my family yesterday that I haven't seen for a few months, and they were like, whoa, you've had your haircut. Then there was this big discussion, whoa, you paid what? And I was like, mum, you never spend that money. I know. But anyway, and I just sort of overreacted to that and burst into tears. Didn't mean to, but it happened. And I just feel like God is so good because he shows us signs when we're not looking for him. He just gives us that confirmation that he loves us and he's still there. Because this morning, an angel, and I'm not naming any names, gave me the exact money of the haircut. And for no, out of complete the blue, why that amount? Why this morning? Why when I was feeling so small and didn't feel worthy? And somebody else also really complimented me this morning, which was lovely as well. But it was just like, that's how good God is to us. He lifts us up when we are down. And I just really wanted to share that.
Good morning. I want to share, I've just started voluntary job at Mind. Monday was best day kind of the week for me. God has now blessed me with giving back to this community. He's blessed me to go and work with people that have struggled similar mental health problems as me. To be in a crisis, Kath, was such an honour and a blessing that has definitely been poured out on me. And so I just want to say thank you to God for that. He does work in ways we cannot see. I also want to share that I've watched another biblical film, and I've only been starting to watch biblical films for this past few months, but they have really, really inspired me, where it takes you down how a person can just be at the lowest point of their life, losing out of their faith, and they find it right at the end that led them away. It's amazing because how real Jesus is, and he's definitely taught me a lot this week, especially with, I was at home once, I had to stay in, so I had to wait for the builders, so he's actually taught me something to spend more time in the home, and more, not enough just going out as well, so... I'm also trying to encourage a friend of mine who's asking questions about Christianity as well. So I'm praying that probably one day she may walk through them doors, because that's quite new as well to me. So, and I'm now kind of preaching over to her and relating to questions of what is Christianity, what is a spiritual battle. I said that God loved us before we were born. We just didn't know him. We didn't know him. We didn't know we had this great God that loved us before we were born. And I happened to found him 30 years later. So thank you.
Morning, everybody. I've been seeking to walk with God every moment of the day, to see more of what he does. And just a couple of things this week that have happened to me. Wednesday morning, I had an appointment to go for a blood test, a repeat one. And it was wet weather. And I couldn't get a lift because my son wasn't well. So I said to the Lord, I need the rain to stop from at least 8:30 till 9:30 so I can go up to the doctor's and get back home without getting soaking wet on the scooter. And it happened. He did it. So that was wonderful. An experience like Mark's, my sister questioned me about my faith, and I was able to share the gospel with her. Not only her, but my other sister and my brother-in-law too, because we have a chat Monday nights on Messenger, so for about an hour, and I was able to witness to them, so that was good. And last night, I was really ill. Don't know what happened. I had a high temperature, felt really poorly, and I thought the room would go and start swimming round and everything. And I just said, Lord, I don't know what's happening, please, but I'm giving it to you. I want to go to church tomorrow. I don't want to miss out. And here I am this morning. So God answers prayer. And he's revealing himself more and more through my days, and it's just wonderful. And it's even in the tiny things, even in the getting dressed. And it's remembering to give him everything and to invite him into everything. I'm still learning that one. I keep forgetting. Because you're so independent, aren't you? You just do things without thinking. And I'm trying to invite him into everything I do. So, but yeah, that's my week. Good. Praise the Lord.
I Morning, everybody. I just wanted to share this news with you all. As some of you know, I've not been working since October. I gave up my job at Unity because it just wasn't, I wasn't happy there. I've had time out. I put my CV on Indeed, and within 3 days, I was given a job opportunity. I prayed to the Lord it will be the job that I wanted. The hours that I wanted, the days that I wanted to work. He guided me back to supporting people with learning and physical disabilities. That's where he wants me to be. He found me the perfect job that fits in with my lifestyle, my church, my family, my friends. I am so, so blessed that he answered my prayers. Everything I've asked for so far since I've been coming to this church, he has done it for me. I am so, so blessed to have him in my life and that I found God and I found all you lovely people. I can't wait to start my new job. It's in Eastern Mordick. Beautiful, beautiful place. It's got everything I want. Woodwork, gardening, growing fruit and veg, animals. Yeah. I can't wait to start. Thank you.
I promise it will be short. You know we're doing about the Word of God, right? The Bible. This was out of my mind, but I'm out of my mind most of the time. There's a little video snippet that I put on the Highfield line by an old African preacher called Johnny James. And he was challenging a Muslim. And he said, my book is better than your book. And he put his little black Bible on top of his Quran. But he tells the story. It's an 8-minute video, but it's all about the authority of the word. It's just dawned on me that it actually sits really well with what we're doing. So have a look at it.
Whoa, hey, bud, that's not a coaster.
Oh, sorry. Yeah. What? That's the Bible. Yeah. What's that doing out?
I was reading it.
You were reading that?
Yes.
At home?
Yes.
Without anybody telling you to?
Yeah.
That's weird. Why would you do that?
I don't know. It's God's word. I thought...
Wait. That's God's word?
Yeah. I mean, it's the gospel. I just...
What? Oh, slow down. So, this Bible that you say is God's word is also the gospel.
Yeah. What did you think it was?
I don't know. I guess I just never put it all together like that. I mean, don't get me wrong. I love the Bible. I mean, it's just that I never read it unless, you know, someone says turn to this verse and follow along. But it's a good book. You know, it's got a lot of positive stories, you know, a lot of really great guys, you know, like the guy who named all the animals and the other guy who put them on a boat and Pharaoh.
Really? Pharaoh. That's it? That's all you got? You think there's just one central character that you might be leaving out?
Yeah, well, of course. I mean, there's the one central figure. So who are you thinking of?
Jesus.
Oh, yeah. That's what I thought.
Yeah.
So it's like we shouldn't just think of the Bible as a good book to read at church, but like an everyday book that can soothe us, activate our imagination, convict us, and bring us closer to God.
Yeah, that's exactly right.
Is this the same Bible with the Old and New Testament?
Yeah,
that's what I thought.
Morning, all. Today's reading comes from Psalm 119, verses 9 to 16. But before we read it, may we say what we normally say. I hold God's word in my hand. It encourages, corrects, and instructs me. Lord, speak to me now. The psalmist asks, how can a young person stay on the path of purity by living according to the word? I seek you with all my heart. Do not let me stray from your commands. I have hidden your word in my heart that I might not sin against you. Praise be to you, Lord. Teach me your decrees. With your lips I recount all of the laws that come from your mouth. I rejoice in the following your statutes as one rejoices in great riches. I meditate on your precepts and consider your ways. I delight in your decrees, and I will not neglect your word. Praise be to God.
I will not neglect your word. This song is one of my kind of go-tos, I guess, before a message on a Sunday. But perhaps it's most relevant with this series. Speak, O Lord. Let's sing.
Speak, O Lord, as we come.
So I was in a shoe shop, trying on some shoes. And I put one on, I said to the assistant, "This is too tight." She said, try it with the tongue out." So I said, "That's still no good, it's still too tight." What is the best way to communicate with God?
Prayer.
Prayer. Good. Yeah, that's the best way to communicate with God. We pray. And that's a two-way communication. What is the best way to get to know God?
Reading the Bible.
Very good. You're going and coming up with the right answers. The Bible is known as God's Word. And most would say if you want to get to know about God, his ways, his expectations, his love, you have to read the Bible. It is a must. Yet most people don't do it. And the reason in many of those cases why people don't read the Bible is that they will say, or they will think, "Well, I don't really believe all that's in it." And to those who say that, to those who find reasons why they don't read the Bible, I will say, but have you really stopped and actually read it? You say you don't believe it, or you say it's boring, or you say it. Have you actually stopped and read it? And then sometimes the people will say, "Well, I started reading Genesis. That was quite interesting. But I gave up when I got to Leviticus or Numbers." And if you're not laughing at that, you haven't read Leviticus or Numbers. And most people, it seems, when you talk to them about the Bible, they will say, "The Bible is boring. The Bible isn't relevant to me." And those who say that haven't usually read it. And those that have read it the wrong way. They might say the wrong way. Yeah, the wrong way. I said, "Well, but it's a book. How many ways can you read the Bible? How many ways can you read a book?" Well, the first thing about the Bible is it isn't a book. It's a library. I've bought my old faithful illustration that I made, I don't know how many years ago, with me today, to kind of say that. It is a book of, it is a library rather, of 66 books. All sorts of things in there. They're all in kind of some kind of bookshelf order, as you would find in a library of some, or a bookcase or whatever. And you can have a look at it afterwards if you so wish. A few of the books are looking a bit tatty nowadays. So it's a library of 66 books. Originally, those 66 books were written in three different languages. Those 66 books were written by 40 writers. There was shepherds, there was kings, there was prophets, there was disciples, there was doctors, there was historians. And so already you kind of think, 66 books written in three different languages over those 66 books, written by 40 different writers. And it was written, those 66 books were written over some 1,500 years. So it's not a book that was written by just one person. Yeah, we'll just keep reading it. It's not a novel where you start at the beginning, page one, and you end at page whatever. Being a library, it's actually got within, as I say, that collection of books. It's got history, It's got poetry. It's got songs. It's got narrative. It's got a rather racy song in it. It's got biography. It's got letters. It's got visions. And it's got the words and the actions of Jesus Christ. Do you know what some people do with a Bible? They use it as a quote book. It's kind of like this is what they do with the Bible. They kind of go,
pick a card. I'll read it so that it's on camera.
Psalm 27, verse 14. Wait for the Lord, be strong, and let your heart take courage. Yes, wait for the Lord. That's pretty good. Well, okay. Let's do another one. This is what people do. We're going to pick another verse. Okay. I'll read that one out so everyone sees it here. Anyone who hates his brother or sister is a murderer. And you know that no murderer has eternal life residing in him. Oh dear. That's a bad one to pick. I think we'll put that one under. And we can go on like that. That's what kind of some people do with the Bible. Oh yeah, I'll pick that verse. Oh yeah, I'll pick that verse. And even they have kind of like daily verses. Now there's nothing actually wrong with having daily verses, but if that's the way you're reading the Bible, if you kind of think, actually every day all I do is pick out a verse or two, that's not reading or studying the Bible. That's just like this, really. Shuffling a few verses around and, oh yeah, I'll have that one. If your right eye causes you to sin, tear it out and throw it away. That's not a good one, is it? Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the man who takes refuge in it. But you see what some people do when they read the Bible. I just had that verse. That's a nice verse. Perhaps they don't even turn the page of the Bible. They just pick out a verse because it's on the calendar or something. Get this up. Last Monday morning, Oswald, bless him, sent me a message on WhatsApp. And he sent that. I thought, oh, good old Oswald, he's a nice, you know, spiritual man. He's sending me a reading for the day. So I looked up Isaiah 13:15, because he said, good for you today. Well, that's good. Isaiah 13, verse 15, whoever is captured will be thrust through, and all who are caught will fall by the sword. What? Why is he sending me that, I thought. And then it dawned on me after a while that he was actually asking, is 13:15 good for you today to meet up? 1:15. Is... That's true. And we can just sort of see a verse. Oh, yeah, that's the verse. What is he sending me that for? Picking a verse out of the Bible can be a nice thought, yeah, to carry us through the day. But it's definitely not the way we should be reading and understanding the Bible. Richard, can you flip to the next screen? That actually says what we're looking at today. Understanding the Bible in 60 minutes. Yeah. Now, I truly believe that the Bible is not boring. It is absolutely relevant for our life today. So how do we read the Bible to ensure that we understand God and his word? How do we do that? So over the next couple of weeks, I want to help you learn how to read and study the Bible so that it makes sense, and that it becomes relevant to our everyday lives. Sound interesting? Yeah. Good. We want to understand the Bible. That's the whole point of this little series. And I really believe that in these two sessions, they could actually be two of the most important sessions that you have in your journey with God. So please take these 60 minutes... Not 60 minutes a day, 30 today, 30 next week, roughly. Take them seriously. Study them. I'm going to give you some thoughts and ideas. You might want to have a bit of paper or something to write them down. Hebrews 4, verse 12, describes the Bible as living, active, powerful, sharp like a sword. If we take time to truly read and understand the Word of God, it will speak to you. It will empower you. It will keep you on your guard against temptation. It will renew your mind. It will build your faith. It will develop your life. It will set you free. So, five things. Five things we're going to look at today that I hope and pray will really help you understand and gain great things from the Bible. Five things about it that we do to do this, to understand the Bible. So if you've got a pen and paper, if you've got a list on your phone, that'll be good. I will say that I've got some notes that you can look at afterwards, but there's nothing like writing it down yourself. So if you can, that would be good. Okay. So, Philemon, chapter 1 and verse 7. For we have great joy and consolation in thy love, because the bowels of the saints are refreshed by thee, brother. Wherefore, though I might be much bold in Christ to enjoin thee that which is convenient, yet for love's sake I'd rather beseech thee. Did that make any sense at all? Not a lot. If you picked up the Bible and read that, I would not be surprised if you went, that's it. So the first thing I want to say out of the five is choose a translation that you understand. That was the King James Version. It was written some 400 plus years ago, around the time of Shakespeare. You understand the language then, can't you? And understand why it's like that. It's an ancient English. It would have been understood 400 years ago, but we don't write like that anymore. We don't speak like that anymore. So it's good to have a different translation that speaks to us today in modern English. So I've picked out a different translation in modern English to say the same words that I've just read from the King James Version that we all went, what to? Here's a modern English version of those words. Your love has given me great joy and encouragement because you, brother, have refreshed the hearts of the Lord's people. Therefore, although in Christ I could be bold and order you to do what you ought to do, yet I prefer to appeal to you on the basis of love. Make a lot more sense?
Yeah.
And then some go, but isn't the Bible the Bible? What's with the translations thing? Well, as I said, the Bible was originally written some 2,000 plus years ago, written in three languages, which we don't read: Hebrew, Aramaic, Greek. And over history, what has happened is that Bible scholars, those that understand the language and so on, understand that the way that the Bible was, those transcripts rather, were written, have translated those words from Aramaic or Hebrew or whatever, and they have translated them into English for us in England, using the understanding that they had at the time when they were translating. So 400 years ago, when the King James Version was written in English, the understanding of the ancient languages, the old Greek and so on, they only had a limited understanding. I mean, they're pretty good, but it was limited. They didn't have lots of scholars and so on of languages to help them out. And of course, the English in those days was very different to today. So, you know, you take a Greek transcript 400 years ago, and you try and transcribe that so you put it into some English, and you're using words that perhaps we don't use today. They had a limited understanding of what a certain word was in Greek, and they kind of thought, well, we'll try and fit that in and so on, because they didn't necessarily know everything about the language. So they did the best they could at that time, 400 years ago. But it's important, really, for us, when it comes to reading and understanding the Bible, that we get a blend. I understand you were looking for these this morning. I got them. And we need a blend. The best understanding of the original language. So you need someone who knows about Greek and Hebrew and Aramaic and all those. They know those languages. They know the words. They know, they've studied it. They've looked at all the transcripts that were written around that time. They've got the best words. So we need this blend of a great understanding of the original language, but we also need to have good English that we understand. You need to put those two together, really, and kind of pour them together to make an English Bible that we can read and understand today. Now, I'm going to recommend, as I have done for a long while, a good blend is the New International Version. I'm not saying it's, you know, the book, if you like, but it's a good blend because scholars have gone through the language. There's a whole team of scholars who have worked out what the original language was, what it meant, how the phrasing was, all those sort of things, because they've studied language and language and language all around that time to try and put everything together. So they have got a really good understanding, the scholars who wrote the New International Version, of the original language. But they have kind of put it in the best English that's not kind of a common English, but it's the best way of kind of following it through as to how it was originally written. So we get a real good understanding of the idea that was originally written in the Bible. There are others. There are many other translations. I will pick out three for you. There is the Contemporary English Version. I quite like that. I would say that the Contemporary English Version is like written in Common English. That makes sense. It's kind of pretty much how we would speak. Perhaps the NIV is a little bit more, they're trying to get the right words from the original, and it's not necessarily how we would speak, but it's quite good English. The Contemporary English Version is a bit more Common English. They're kind of, you know, how we would talk. The Good News Version, I would say, is basic English. The Good News Version is often used for people whose English is their second language. So it's a very basic, simple English. Nothing wrong with it, but that's how the Good News is. So if you kind of struggle perhaps with your reading, the Good News is quite a good one because it's very basic English. There is the Message. The Message is kind of conversational English, is how I would put it. It's written in paragraphs. Kind of the words are taken around so that you get the basic meaning. I would say it's kind of sometimes over-blended. It's a bit like you get all the flavour of the Bible, but you can't really distinguish what the ingredients are because they've kind of been blended together so much. But sometimes it's good to read the Message, and I have done it, and I've used it on sometimes here, because it gives a different, it gives a sort of a flavour of what the whole passage is about without reading it sort of word for word. But the basic thing, number one thing out of the five, get a translation that you understand. If you're starting to read the words and you're going, I don't know about that, you know, King James is, ooh. There is a new King James which kind of updates it. This is important that you get a version that you kind of go, yeah, I understand it. This is like how I would normally read, so I'm getting to really grips with it. So that's the first thing. Get a translation that you understand. I mean, we on a Sunday use the New International Version so that we all agree on something to read, but you get what I'm saying. The second thing is plan a time to read and study the Bible, a time and a place. I would really recommend that you develop a consistent time and place to read the Bible. I mean, yeah, we can read it anytime. And maybe you want to read it at different times. But when it actually comes to studying, when it comes to looking at a passage in the scripture, I would say stop and say, okay, I'm going to make whatever. Consistency is important. If you don't have a consistent time and place, it's likely that you won't stick to it. Oh, I missed that today because I was doing this today or whatever. You need to have some sort of consistency. So maybe first thing in the morning, even if you've got to get up a bit earlier, okay, I'm gonna before I do anything else, I won't get interrupted by anybody and my schedule's not until later, I will read and study God's word for 15, 30 minutes or whatever. Or maybe lunchtime. Maybe in your situation, lunchtime is a good time to just sit down and read God's word and study it. And you have a little place, you have a table, you have a chair or something you go to. Maybe sit with your Hebrews coffee. Again, we have different ways that we can read the Bible now. We have... So we have a paper version. People like a paper version, I get that. And people can even write notes or highlight things in the paper version. That's fine. But there's also, because you can get your phone or your tablet and you can get a Bible on there to read. If you haven't got one, you don't know how to do it, and you've got a phone or a tablet, see me and we'll try and sort it out for you. Some people listen to the Bible. It can have its pluses and minuses doing that, but certainly there are some positives in listening to the Bible. And alongside having the Bible, alongside having a time and a place to do that, it is good also to have some kind of studying word. Again, not one that just picks out a verse or tells you a lovely story. Because some of those devotionals do that. And again, nothing wrong with that, but you're not really going to study the word by just picking out a verse or someone telling you a lovely story about someone. So to get something that gives a little bit more meat, a little bit more flesh on the words that you're reading, and just have that alongside your Bible reading for that day. So, translation, that you understand, time and a place. Third thing, understand the context. This is so important and is so often ignored. Especially when you do a kind of a lucky dip. You got no context. I mean, you know, as I say, we picked out, what was the one I said? Anyone who hates his brother and sister is a murderer, and you know that no murderer has eternal life residing in him. I mean, if you just read that, what's that about? You might start then asking questions about how you think and... Because context is important. I found this the other day. I can do all things from a verse taken out of context. Pretty much right. I mean, if you want to prove something, there's a verse in the Bible you can kind of prove. You know, just get that one. Just take that little bit out there. Look, see, I can do that now because it says it in the Bible. Context is very important. We must not take a verse out of context, because that'll prove anything. For instance, let me give you two examples, popular examples of taking a verse out of context. First one, Matthew 18 and verse 20, "For where two or three are gathered in my name, there I am among them." This verse is usually taken out of context. It's kind of plucked out of a paragraph that actually begins in Matthew 18 and verse 15. It's not about prayer. So many people take that, oh, well, there's two or three of us gathered for prayer. And nothing wrong with that. It is absolutely true that, you know, if there's two or three of you gathered for prayer, it's the important thing. But that's not the context of this verse. Matthew 18, verses 15 to 19, is not about prayer. It's about discipline. Let me read it in the context. If your brother sins against you, go and tell him his fault between you and him alone. If he listens to you, you have gained your brother. But if he does not listen, take one or two others along with you, that every charge may be established by the evidence of two or three witnesses. If he refuses to listen to them, tell it to the church. And if he refuses to listen even to the church, then let him be as a Gentile and a tax collector. In other words, cast him out. Truly I say to you, whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. Again I say to you, if two of you agree on earth about anything they ask, it will be done for them by my Father in heaven. For where two or three are gathered in my name, there I am among them. See the context? That doesn't disprove the way that we normally think of it, but it's taken out of context because it's all about discipline at this point. Here's another well-known verse in the Bible. Revelation 3 and verse 20. Here I am, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in and eat with that person and they with me. And often we see this picture of Jesus standing outside, normally kind of an unbeliever's house, heart, door, asking to come in. And sometimes gospel messages were even preached on that. In other words, we think, we know, that it's a passage about the unbeliever, the person who's not a Christian, opening their lives to Jesus who's standing at the door waiting. Do you know what the context is of that? Is it written to unbelievers? No. It is in Revelation, part of the letters that were sent out by the Lord to churches. So this was written as a letter with these words in to a church, a group of Christians. So in context of Revelation 3, we see it's not about Jesus wanting to come into the life of an unbeliever. Rather, it is about how we as believers can become so lukewarm, to use the phrase there, and self-sufficient, that we kind of push Jesus away and we leave him out of our lives, even in a church. And there is Jesus standing at the door, wanting to come in. So context is vitally important in reading the Bible. So when someone kind of quotes a Bible passage or a text or a verse or something, what's the context of that? What was said before it? What was said after it? Who was it written to? What words come before and come after give us some kind of context usually. For instance, if you take the whole thing, the Gospel of Matthew tells the story of Jesus. But it was written for a very different purpose and a very different readership than the Gospel of John. And when you read the Gospel of Matthew and the Gospel of John, they both tell the stories of Jesus and the other two Gospels as well. But they are writing for a different readership. So you need to have that context. Because why does John seem quite different to the other three? You know, why does Matthew include certain things that Mark doesn't, and so on. There's a context to that. So, the version that you understand, a time and a place to read it, you check out the context of the passage that you are reading. So that takes time. You've got to sit and you've got to think and you've got to perhaps even read up somewhere what the context is. And then when you read the section that you're looking at in the Bible, ask at least two questions. And these are quite important questions. The first question is, when you're reading this passage of the Bible, what does it say to me about God? What does it say to me about God? Is there something in this passage? If this is God's word, it will tell me something about God. It will tell me something about his character. It will tell me something about his nature. It will tell me something about the way he looks at us as people. It will tell us about his goodness. You know what I mean? What does this tell us about God as I'm reading this word? It's a good question to ask when you're reading a passage out of the Bible. Now, since you're all going to come back next week, and you're going to join us next week online, I'm going to tell you that next week I am going to hopefully bring this alive in what I hope is a great way, an amazing way. So come back next week and see how this could actually change your life by reading a passage in the Bible in this way. So the first question you ask as you read a Bible passage, what does this tell me about God? Because he is the author of the book. So he included this, he wrote this, he did this, he actioned this for some reason, and we can understand him. So we need to ask that question. What does this tell me about God? Second question we need to ask when we're reading a Bible passage, what is God saying to me? What's God saying to me? If this word that I'm reading is alive and bright and sharp and all that, what is God saying to me through this passage? What are you trying to tell me, Lord? How should I behave? What should I be doing? Is there something that you're giving me a nudge about by reading this passage? So choose a translation you understand, time and a place that you can study every day. Get the context. Read the passage carefully and ask those questions. Number five. Pray for God to speak to you, that you can then apply what he says to you to your life. It's like the song that we sung before we got to this message. Speak, O Lord. If God is the author of this book, we need to say, Lord, will you speak to me through it? We get to know God through the Bible, but we get to talk with him through prayer. And we need both of those going on at the same time, really. Make this word that I'm going to read now come alive. What are you trying to tell me? How many read a few words from the Bible and think, I get what this means. That's nice. That's a nice little sentiment. That's a nice idea. That's a good thought for the day. And then you kind of close it. Or maybe you think, no, no, that's not very relevant to me, and close it. And that's it. This book can really change lives. This book can change our relationships. This book can alter the trajectory of someone's future. This book. So this week, hold it, set aside a time and a place to open it, get a version that makes sense to you, seek the context, whatever way you can, ask questions of it, and make sure it's surrounded by praying to God that he will speak to you through the words that you're reading. Now, next week, we're going to put all these things into practice. And we're going to do a study of a section in the Bible. I'm going to walk you through a way to study the Bible that I pray will make it alive and exciting and relevant. Is that okay? Good. Last Sunday, Oswald was here, standing here, and he talked about aligning yourself with the Bible. Not fitting some Bible verses around the way you live, which is what some people do. But rather saying, how can I line my life up with what the Bible teaches? And there's a big difference. So let's start asking, what does the Bible actually say? What does the Bible actually mean? Let's get it in context. How can I align myself? How can I kind of work and live parallel to what the Bible teaches me? I hope you're getting excited about the Bible. And come back next week and we'll carry on doing this in our other 30 minutes. Let's pray together. Father God, thank you for this word, the Bible. It is alive, and so many of us will say that we read it and we reread it, and you speak to us, you instruct us, you help us. We talk about that as we read your word on a Sunday morning, that it will encourage, correct, instruct us. Lord, we are excited to explore more of your word this week. Help us to try and align things better, that we get a version that we understand, that we set aside time, that we ask questions, that we try and get the context of it, and we surround our whole reading with prayer. Lord, send us out from here this morning challenged to study your word. In Jesus' name, amen. So a nice song to finish off with. God is good all the time. Thank you for your mercies, for your love, for your guidance in life. We thank you for your word that we read in the Bible. And Father, we're going to leave here in a little while's time, and we're going to go out into the world, and we're going to have all sorts of situations thrust upon us. We pray, Lord, that we might rest on your word, on your promises. And Lord, that wonderful promise that you said, every step you take, every place you go, I am going to be with you. He's going to be there in our defeats and in our victories, in our bad times and in our good times, in our dark days and in our bright days, because we can count on the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
Amen.